Time for me to ramble through some general thoughts on stuff again. Fandom is one of those things that comes alongside getting into anything, really. As a social species, we humans like to do things together. Likewise, when we enjoy something like media, we then go and seek to interact with and share these ideas with others. From this, I've seen some very set kind of patterns arise. Games that require more reflex-based competitive atmospheres will often foster, rather unsurprisingly, very competitive fandoms of players, where quick adaptive teamwork is highly prized. In comparison, games that orient instead on far more rigorous, scientific, or very slow, analytical gameplay will likewise encourage a far more rigorous and analytical community, with far more phlegmatic and civil fandoms. Beyond the specifics of particular media forms, it's hard not to notice just how different people approach being a fan. For some, just sitting down and giving over a few hours of weekly time is plenty, while for others, expensive elaborate trips to exclusive specific events is a must-have aspect of their life. Even beyond something like time and money, the very way different people approach fandom can vary widely. For a long time as I grew older, and started both refining my scientific understanding and artistic skills, I began to see my own personal approach changing as well. Something I fundamentally began to understand was that some people like myself are kinda cursed with a very analytical brain. We digest media very thoroughly, breaking it down, and taking its ideas and connections, and seeing how they relate to other works. In a way, these things kind of reflect my current understanding of fandom, of the axis of love-ems, hate-ems, and the analytical critics, and analytical fans. Of course, this is a bit of a simplification, but it largely followed how I began to understand how various different people came to enjoy and be fans of their favorite media. Now don't be mistaken, what might resonate deeply for one person and make them very analytical does not always make them 100% an analytical fan, non-stop and vice versa. Like sure, I'll always be hungry for a super complex story with meaty ideas, and I'd say in general I'm very analytical and I'm usually in that area. But at the same time, sometimes you just want to watch Redline again, because, well, you know, it's Redline. It's fucking cool. It's beautiful, and it really does not need to be about anything more complex than a big kick-ass race. Now, love-ems and hate-ems, though, oof, there is no way to say it, but, you know, when you're an analytical person like myself, it's kinda inevitable that you start to conflict with these groups. Of course, I can disagree about interpretations of stuff with analytical types as well, but the tension is entirely different. It's one of discussing interpretation, usually. These other groups are separate in their fandom, not by some intellect, but rather by their approach. They feel the same elements, and want to talk about them just as the analytical types do, but they do so differently. For me, though, the tension will always somewhat remain. I've always been someone to find what I love and hold it close. I'll largely kind of ignore popularity and often enough be dismissive of it. I blame this firmly on my combination of being very analytical, but also very, very stubborn. As an individual, if I find something that's worthy of merit, or has quality, or if its form or execution are, you know, very good, I will say as such, and I don't really care for age. Personally, I think this is a massive hurdle in my opinion, where fans and especially fandoms initially might ignore older, better works simply for being old. I'm always very saddened by this, especially when time is such an illusory thing when it comes to how easy it is to watch or enjoy older stuff now. As well, there's always this kind of haunting possibility, this feeling that, you know, I might make a work or enjoy a work separated from my audience or separated from the creator by decades or, I don't know, hundreds of years. Sometimes you just get in right at the tail end, and it's a bittersweet feeling, but if you are a fan of something down to your bones, then it's just who you are, but you know that at the end of the day you probably missed the boat on what was the glory days of that thing. As another aspect, I don't care much for preconceived notions of great games or films if I have not understood or found someone else who has understood the reasons for such. I don't usually respect those arguments as anything more than subjective opinion. This has unfortunately led me time and time again to conflict with the two lower extremes of the chart, the love-ems and the hate-ems. Now, hate-ems are one group perhaps most at the whims of the hype cycle. These fans and fandoms vehemently cling to whatever their chosen, usually childhood nostalgia franchise of choice is, and either dismissively or violently reject all others. Bennett the Sage is a fantastic example of this. If the show he likes was not broadcast on Toonami within a specific time frame, then nope, it's garbage, or it's never really gonna be as good. Returning to the hype cycle, the reason this group is so much a victim is because they have ingrained their chosen media so deeply into their personality that, you know, when wind of some new thing comes up, they're always chasing that memory of a nostalgic carefree time, you know, when they first watched Bleach, or Star Wars, or played Zelda, or whatever impossible to recapture thing happened. Because hey, when you grow up, you fucking grow up. So this cues the incessant, bring back X, my favorite show. Then something new comes up. It's gonna save anime. It's gonna be the biggest thing ever. It's gonna be the game of the year. It's finally gonna meet those impossible expectations. And wow, ta-da, it has flaws, so now it's the worst thing ever. Boo. Times have changed. Now, to be fair, some new things are just bad, and a bit of nostalgia for bygone days in healthy amount is not really a bad thing. But this man-child approach to idealizing stuff to such an extreme, and to clinging to things so blindingly within these fandoms is just kind of childish, and I find it very fucking stupid. Next up, though, we have the Love'ems. Now, Love'ems are not exactly worse or better. It's just a different extreme group. They are annoying, but in a very different way. Love'ems just enjoy things. I know, right? It's so dumb. No, but seriously, they like things, and they just don't dive into them. On a case-by-case basis, at best, they're just kind of, you know, boring or frustratingly uninteresting. One of my best high school pals was a huge Metal Gear fan, and when I got into Metal Gear, I, of course, wanted to talk all about these concepts and all these crazy ideas, and he just kind of sort of said, you know, fair enough, quite a lot. There's once again a feeling of frustration and isolation when you try to talk to other fans about the complexities of artists or who worked on what things, or maybe the underlying worldly politics or the science that went into how they were designed, and, you know, they start saying things like, ha, it's all fiction, this doesn't matter, or, oh well, you know, none of it's realistic, haha, or, just turn your brain off, don't think about it, be like your cousin Johnny. If Hatems are way too selective and overly negative, then Love'ems lack any good amount of selectivity or critique, and instead prefer to just sidestep the issue wholesale. Personally, I don't sympathize with this conflict aversion because you can't really analyze anything in depth or dig into the ideas of a work as a fan if you also need to placate all these, you know, conflict-averse individuals who prefer not to deal or think about these things and just want to fucking like things. They don't want to think about those things. One of the things you learn in science is you can't really measure something without changing it, and this applies to media as well. These fans also, in this quadrant, fall victim quite often, though Hatems can as well, to the gratefulness overdrive syndrome. To best describe it, all I have to say is, have you ever heard, well, we should just be happy X exists? Like, hey, once again, on its own specific stuff, sure, making a piece of media can be an uphill climb. But after, for example, I only barely dipped my toes into game development on some small projects, I'm at this point completely demystified. This concept of fans worshipping and being grateful to devs, praising games as this miraculous gift from the heavens, I never liked it. Yes, it's fun to be excited. It's fun to get hype, but games are still just made by people. Devs can be great, or they can be assholes. People praising publishers I find even more fucking bizarre, considering how, at the end of the day, they don't actually make the game. In the age of digital sales as well, their reason for existing and their evil, putrid, black, dripping, swollen, pus-filled state seems less and less logical. I think a lot of this has to do, really, with people not actually, you know, knowing how the sausage gets made when it comes to games or movies. If you honestly just showed people a 10 to 20 minute video on, like, a development process with some examples of, like, you know, good and bad films or albums or games, I would kind of hope this kind of approach would die out a bit. Anyway, these were some of my personal gripes in dealing with these extreme fandom archetypes. I think once again, I want to bring it back and focus on the Ace Combat fandom. Now, it's not all bad for sure. In fact, fandom communities can be quite amazing. In just the Ace Combat community, there are several great examples of very useful, hardworking folks who have done some really fantastic stuff. So here, allow me to highlight some cool-ass folks who've done some neat stuff in the community. For example, while searching around recently, I came across some really cool videos of what appeared to be a heavily modified level in Ace Combat, adjusted through the emulator's active rendering process to visually adjust how the levels came out. The account's name is Charlse Charleston, and they have done some really neat work in switching up just how these levels look. If you are already familiar with the series, then seeing the variations here will be enough to just show how cool some of these alterations are. I will link there and all the other folks I mentioned here down in the description. Now, all of that would take quite a fair bit of work to, you know, figure out. So continuing in that vein, I also want to mention Krishty, who for quite a while now has been painstakingly extracting the models, textures, level data, and level textures from Ace Combat 2 and Ace Combat 3. Thanks to the hard work, we now have this incredible ability to see some of these levels outside of the limitations of PS1 hardware, which would usually cap their render distance, among other things. I mean, damn, some of these shots just gorgeously show off the hand-painted pixel decor, and the beauty of these earlier, often ignored games. In terms of data extraction, the current king working hard on 7 is Keystone, another member of the fandom who I would say was instrumental in pulling apart and piecing together our best picture of the complicated development of Ace Combat 7. There's only only a quick shout out, as I will go in depth in Seven's video soon enough anyways, but for now, all I want to say is thank you for all the hard work involved in sorting through the actual thousands of files present. Finally, perhaps I want to give the biggest fucking thank you on earth to DragonspikeXIII and the whole Project Nemo team. These guys went out of their way in their free time to translate and make Ace Combat 3 Electrosphere, something English speakers could only play with in a limited account, finally able to engage with in full. Without the hard work and effort of these people, I would likely still not have played 3, nor enjoyed what ended up being one of my all-time favorite cyberpunk game, and really a great cyberpunk story. I still feel it's a game sadly ignored because of the original barriers like language and the translation effort in the original European and Western release. The work this team put out not only enhanced or made sense of something, it arguably restored 3's form in the West to the original point, where people like myself who otherwise would not have been able to play the game at all could experience it, and they did it pretty much for free as a passion project. So really, I cannot overstate how much I appreciate the efforts of translators like Project Nemo in making new and wonderful art and stories available, without whom my Ace Combat 3 video would for sure not exist. Now, having said all that, I'm not magnanimous. In particular, there are 2 things which I dislike, but the reasons I will mention them here is because I think they kind of indicate larger negative trends. This isn't really an attack on a personal level, but my gripes are not really my main point. Rather, it's that these groups are kind of indicative of larger negative aspects. Firstly, I think it goes without saying that wikis hold a lot of sway. A wiki quickly becomes the fastest online sourcing for information for a fandom. Who controls it and what gets written down can perpetuate outright misinformation. For smaller communities, that one dude who might be the only one willing to painstakingly write everything down will have a huge power over what later people who might find that series think. There are a few quite suspect pages on Wikipedia, which is usually stringent, but for niche anime, for example, they have incorrect facts because one obsessive fucking fan has his show locked down, and it's their thing even though they're wrong and they won't really let it up at any point. This basically leads into my first gripe, and it's basically the power of canon, or power of what is considered an official part of the lore of a fictional world, and how it is important to sometimes just fucking ignore it for fans, basically. Now, the object of my disdain in particular relates to a personal mistake I made. When I was first getting into Ace Combat years ago, I, of course, checked the wiki, but the franchise was quite large. And what was this? Many of the Ace Combat 2 pages had non-canon written under them. Well, that's odd. Now, of course, I thought, well, you know, everyone talks about the PS2 games mainly anyways, right? And hey, Namco said Ace Combat 3 was in this weird other timeline with, like, a Dig Dug or something? So I guess that determines it, right? Wrong. See, Ace Combat fans are weirdly fucking obsessed with canon sometimes, asking largely pointless questions like, which plane does Mobius 1 canonically fly? Or, you know, when you have a universe that's pretty sparse, you get some interesting interpretations that, to me, have always felt like people trying to fill in the gaps or read into things a bit too much. Wait, Argonbolt, you had a whole friggin' video on your interpretation of Ace Combat 0, right? Yeah, but would I want that on the wiki? Hell no. I can criticize 5 here in video form, but I also probably would not want that or praise for 0 on the wiki. Wiki should always strive for objectivity. Is it always possible? Maybe not, but it should always be the goal. This leads me to the page that I still personally very much hate, the official wiki canon page. Now, if I have not made it abundantly clear before, one of the things with the fandom I find perhaps most unfair is just how much one of the weakest titles like 5 can get praise over older and later stronger titles simply because of external factors or nostalgia bias. And look at that, which 2 mainline games have non-canon in this stupid guide? Now, is there a big bias for the PS2 games causing this? The answer is yes, and that's fucking stupid. Ace Combat already plays fast and loose with how much each game largely acknowledges the previous events, yet Ace Combat 2 has moved to non-canon over Assault Horizon Legacy, a gutted version that misses some of 2's strongest aspects like its soundtrack? What? I mean, Ace Combat 4, and especially 7, barely cared about 2's or Assault Horizon Legacy's events either way, and Ace Combat 3's roots are non-canon because it's a simulation or something? Or because they contradict and overlap? I mean, Bamco already could not decide if it cared enough to even have 3 in Strange Reel or not. I mean, the canon here, it feels like people just being frustrated without being able to pin things down exactly one way or another. It feels like people not being open to the concept of just contradicting outcomes. I mean, bitch, have you seen SMT's timelines? Have you seen Dragon Guard's timelines? Their wikis have multiple timeline tabs. Look at how complex that shit gets. And that wiki has its roots locked down. SMT has multiple canonical roots spinning out every week. each way. In comparison, Ace Combat 3 only having 5 outcomes looks pretty simplistic. One of them will probably come true, or, you know, maybe that's just not the point. Maybe the point is that all of them are important, even if they overlap. It just kind of adds another layer of stupidity to the question of canonity. Now, is the Ace Combat Wiki the worst? No, not by a long shot. A lot of the older game site sources have been translated and added here. Hell, even the non-canon sections in the Ace Combat 2 page I think have been mostly disappeared. So you might ask, well, what's the issue then? That it goes back to my point on canon largely. Unless it is meticulously scripted out or very planned by the creators, canon can be one of the messiest parts of a series. It can lead to endless debating, and it can sideline and really rot the point of the actual show or movie or whatever, and basically turn every conversation into a pedantic argument. Mistaking canon, I mean, for a surefire guide to what is important or what is vital or what has quality is largely a mistake. I mean, imagine if the shitty tie-in game Northern Wings was made the only canon game, would that make it good? Would that make it important? Sometimes you just need to ignore canon altogether, and ultimately with Ace Combat, many of these games leave such an open area for you to make your own understanding. For Ace Combat, the wiki should reflect this openness. As irritating as it might be for people who have that obsessive categorizational brain, the alternative of trying to force one understanding ultimately just locks out the other possibilities, and to me will always feel like information-based gatekeeping. This also leads to my last series of points, on particular Ace Combat fan. On a purely subjective level, I do find his voice and general behavior fucking annoying. But the main factor that I really want to focus in is similarly the power of authority. That is something widely applicable to any large video channel or personality, where people just parrot the opinions and ideas based purely on the popularity and not merit of argument or merit of actual experience. Now, the main reason I also dislike these aspects of fandom is actually something else, though. It's in his name, Ace Combat Fan. I've seen this happen before, and I dislike it pretty much every time. Now, I know firsthand how much being a part of a fandom can mean, how happy it can make people, and how much it can comprise their identity. But I also know that when you go in balls deep, when you start to become a kind of human billboard, the analytical barrier starts to disintegrate, and it doesn't matter how bad the media may get, or how abusive the company might be, or how low the quality, the sheer brand loyalty will cloud any reasonable criticism. I just dislike it because for fans like me, analytical ability and digging into a series and its ideas is my meat and potatoes. Also, it's still a fictional experience. Self-awareness and self-separation from our fandom and media keeps things in perspective and keeps us from spiraling into a diluted escapism as well. I'm not really expecting him to stop anytime soon, but I want to contrast this with my last point of focus. I want to mention one last community member that I think in their actions reflect a deeper, interesting aspect of fandom. Someone who basically highlights the issue of trying to stretch some franchise, especially a markedly niche one like Ace Combat, over your personality. TomCat171. Someone who, in the relatively small Ace Combat community, is a longtime contributor. Many fans, including myself, got our first tastes of Ace Combat levels and gameplay from his videos. Recently though, after a long period of losing interest, he deleted his channel and videos. But you know what? I don't blame him. Well, okay, I kinda fucking wish he did not get rid of that fucking red light Need for Speed aim. I mean, holy shit, that one was a fucking killer. It's so freaking good, someone must have backup. If you do, please really send it to me, I need it. And I mean, sure, he could have left his old videos up. But largely though, I don't blame him. Because I kinda understand. When we get into a fandom, really get into it, and let it dominate and characterize a period of our life, it's a big deal. But people change. Franchises and media change. Things we once love and might be a part of us, it might move on from. Even more so when you create and dedicate time not just to consuming but to making your own media about media, it becomes a shared thing. It becomes a part of yourself and a commitment in a big way. And ultimately, sometimes enough is just enough. I personally, after Seven's video, might really have only enough material for maybe 2 or 3 really worthwhile videos on Ace Combat, which I might not make for a while. Outside of which, I might make a joke vid or some DLC stuff maybe, but also maybe not. At that point, I will likely fully move on to a much broader of my passions, mecha and science fiction or who knows what. So I apologize in advance for people who expected this channel to be nothing but Ace Combat. When I think of how much time TomCat171 dedicated to Ace Combat, I mean, I can't imagine ever committing that much, but I don't see walking away as a negative reaction to that. A franchise can entirely go to shit. Sometimes no matter how deep your fandom and your passion for a series, you can't replicate enjoying it exactly the same way. As we live our lives, we go through many changes. People pass away. People are born. People fall in and out of love, even without a childhood playing it. Who I was when I started playing Ace Combat is not the same person who I am now. In the end, I'm not really saying you can't let the worlds you explore in fiction not be a part of you. I've certainly let it happen to me. But in trying to so squarely anchor our identities within these things, to try to stretch them over our entire lives, they inevitably grow thin or tear. Sometimes it's best, perhaps, to be a fan in a patient and tempered manner. Enjoy something. Love it deeply. Then let it rest and leave it be. Let time go by. Walk away and let yourself forget about it, bit by bit, so that one day, after a long while, when you've not even thought about it in years or ages, you can return and savor it delicately once again.